Good morning. Thank you for coming. We're going to start our second day of our conference with a plenary lecture. Our keynote speaker is Professor Richard Laird from the School of Oriental African Studies from the University of London. Professor Laird is Professor of Indian Cultures and Cinema. She her PhD research was on the Gujarati lyrics of Bairam. She teaches undergraduate and postgraduate courses in cinema and supervises PhD research on Indian cinema. Her main research interest is in Hindi cinema, where she has researched and published in film magazines and popular fiction, as well as other topics such as consumerism and the new middle classes and middle growth, love and eroticism, visual culture, religion, emotions, Ghanaian biopic, stars, and other topics. She has written a book in the British Film Institute's Woods Director series about one of the great figures of the Hindi film industry, Yash Chopra, with whom she has worked for 7 years. She later wrote BFI's Guide to 100 Bollywood Films. Her most recent book is Bollywood's India, Hindi Cinema as a Guide to Modern India. Fesplay is currently co-investigator on the AHHRC network grants of Power Cinema and the BRICS with Dr. Stephanie Tennyson, University of Leeds. Her topic today is My Name is Anthony Gonsalves, Imagining Goans in Hindi Cinema. We welcome Professor Bayer. Professor, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and my thanks also to the organisers of the conference for inviting me here. It's lovely to be here in Lisbon, and it seems a sort of coincidence perhaps in the last year as a very much a non-Portuguese speaker, I'm sorry to say, that I seem to have spent so much time in the Portuguese speaking world, whether it's been Goa or Brazil or now back in Lisbon. So please excuse my linguistic incompetence in these matters. Now I'm going to start with a clip. Somebody last night said to me, "You're showing documentaries." I hope nobody thinks this is a documentary, but I want to explain why I've called my paper "My Name is Anthony Gonsalves." And I'm just going to begin by showing you a clip. This is Anthony Gonsalves. The name is clearly a Goan name. Is a character in this film about national integration. There are three brothers, Amar, a Hindu, Akbar, a Muslim, and Anthony, a Christian. They were born Hindus, but they were separated. They were lost as children under a statue of Mahatma Gandhi on India's Independence Day. And the film is about how they come back together to form this complete India. And I'll talk a little bit more about it later, but I'm going to begin with Anthony Gonsalves celebrating Easter, Goan style, in Bombay.
You see, the whole country of the system is juxtapositioned by the Hegel problem in the atmosphere, because you are a sophisticated rhetorician intoxicated by the exuberance of your own verbosity.
My name is Anthony Gonsalves.
What song is it?
Wait, my name is Anthony Gonsalves. My duniya mein akela hoon. Dil bhi hai khali, ghar bhi hai khali. Isme rahegi koi kismat wali. Aaj jisne liya tha jab chahe chali aaye. Jisne liya tha jab chahe chali aaye.
So I think you get an idea here. This is India's superstar. This is probably one of the most famous men in the world, of which perhaps not so many people in Portugal have heard. Amitabh Bachchan here. And here you can see some instant characteristics of Anthony Gonsalves, not only the Easter egg, the idea of the dance, of people wearing Western dress and so on, but the language used. He's a lot of English. What? My name is Anthony Gonsalves, and that speech, which you may not have recognised, but it's partly taken from Benjamin Disraeli, a British Prime Minister's speech there. And he's also associated with alcoholism. He's drunk, going to seem to be drunks, and associated closely with the church and the Christian calendar rather than the Indian calendar of the seasons here. Anthony Gonzalez, the name, is actually the name of a famous musician in the Indian film industry. And one of the things that I'm not talking about today is the fact that the Indian film industry's music, which I'm sure many of you are aware that Indian films all have music in them, usually song and dance, is largely, a great amount of it is dependent on Goans, with their knowledge of orchestration of music and Western instruments and so on there. And Anthony Gonzalez was a famous violinist and arranger in here, who apparently in the 1960s went off to study in Syracuse University, leaving this world behind. We also get an image there of women in India. There's a stereotypical image of the Goan woman, Sandra from Bandra. I'll be talking more about Bandra, a suburb of Bombay. Women as secretaries or nurses wearing Western clothes. And really, many of these images are these we find in the Hindi film industry. And my interest today is how much Goa and the Goans who live outside Goa are shown as exotic. What the idea of the exotic is, because for many of us here, the Hindi film industry is seen as something exotic. And I'm looking more at the idea of the exotic of representation within the films than the films themselves being exotic. And the idea of somehow our Goans and Goans, just a kind of blank space on which you can project certain ideas and images of the other, of the Christian, of different ways of being, like that of Kashmir, perhaps, in Indian cinema. Two states in India which are exceptional, but in very different ways. I'm talking today about the Hindi film industry. As many of you know, the state language of Goa is Konkani, which is an Indo-Aryan language. It's a little like Marathi. It's written in the same script as Marathi and Hindi, Marathi being the state language of Maharashtra, and Hindi being not the national language, but the official language of India, and Konkani being something closely associated with Goa. And there is a Konkani cinema, there is a Marathi cinema, but I'm talking about the Hindi cinema, the biggest film industry in India, allegedly the biggest film industry in the world, not in terms of money, but in terms of the number of films made. India is this great producer of films. It's now known as Bollywood, and there are many myths about this cinema itself. It's a very odd cinema. It's made in Bombay, now known as Mumbai, since 1995, where Hindi is not the official language, but it's a cinema where many people are migrants from the north. Hindi is spoken in North India largely, as well as in urban areas. But it's also a cinema which portrays the idea of North India as normal. The norm in Hindi cinema is the upper class, upper caste Hindu. Usually, the man is usually the lead figure in a film. And anybody else is seen as usually comical. Regional, different regions of India are seen as largely being a source of humour. And also we need to think about different ideas of religion in cinema as well. Very important here, the biggest majority of India's 1.25 billion people are Hindus, over 80%, but Muslims are the substantial minority. They're called the minority. They're seen as being the other, and Christians, as 2.3% of the population, are seen as rather marginal. But Goa is seen as a Christian state. Of course, it's not. It's only about 28% Christian, and this week we've seen the election of a Hindu nationalist government there. But it's seen as representing this idea of Christianity. And I'm not going to talk about that today, but the idea of Goa and the Goans' view, not of themselves within the films, but the way in which Goans are seen in the film of Maharajani, Govinds are as Indian as anybody else, but they're also different. And what these differences are and what they mean, I think, is important. Now, this is the Hindi cinema's view of Goa, rather than a realistic one. Hindi cinema is not realistic in any sense. The characters aren't realistic, the situations aren't realistic, it doesn't want to be realistic. It's not a failure to be realistic, it's a rejection of realism as an aesthetic. These are films about an imaginary world and how it could and should be. So one of the things that in this cinema you'll see is very little reference to anything Portuguese. I think that's quite important here. And what is so surprising is given that the Portuguese had a much longer history in India than the British, were there for far longer. I mean, as you know, Vasco da Gama first lands in India in 1498, and India is just known as Portuguese India for 4.5 centuries. It seems to be largely forgotten outside Goa itself. As you know, there have been many changes politically within Goa, but Goa remained part of Portugal till 1961, although British India ended in 1947. And 1961, I hope I won't offend people here if I call it the liberation of Goa, which is what it's known as in India, rather the invasion of Goa, as it's known here, though I was told I should call it mudança, change, rather than anything else. And of course, Portugal didn't recognise Goan independence till 1975 with the fall of the Second Republic. Goa only became an Indian state in 1987, so it has a very problematic history here. And one of the big differences is also not just in this time frame, but also I think we need to think about the different policies of colonialism that the British had from the Portuguese. The Portuguese sought to assimilate the Goans, to Lusitanize them, as we might say, which is very different from the British idea, which was pronounced as early as 1834, the idea that to make a class of citizens who would be like us, but not the same. And that sort of difference there, I think, is important. Now, a handful of films have dealt with the Portuguese in Goa, usually fighting against people fighting for Goan independence. But the majority of films show Goan characters set in Goa, usually touristic images of Goa with some exoticism from the Portuguese past. Christian heritage, especially the churches, feature a lot in films, have become very controversial that objections, including to this film, Maharajani, the depiction of churches. But the landscapes, the beaches, and even the tourist hotels have become very much part of it. And a whole series of films which have these Goan characters in them have become major hits. I suppose one of the things we might be thinking about is, you know, what would the traces of Portuguese Goa be expected in cinema? We don't hear much Portuguese language, and indeed the Goan Christian imagery seems to be becoming more associated with English than with Portuguese. Even the names are changing. The older Goans I know have names like Maria Couto, Gerson de Cunha, Mario Miranda, Geronimo Pinto, and so on. But now they're taking on what it seems Indian names, Naresh Fernandez, Dilip D'Souza, and so on, and changing this more and more. But Goan law remains Portuguese. The law of the Comunidades, I know that everybody trying to buy a Goan holiday home has come up against this, and the Portuguese civil code remains in place, a Napoleonic code rather than laws based on Britain. Portuguese food, or the idea of Portuguese food, is very much part of India, of Goan culture, and Portugal's great legacy to India, the cashew nut, making a really, I find, disgusting drink. Roman Catholics remain 28% of the population of Goa, and the church is very powerful. A mixture of Portuguese Catholicism with Hindu practices, and the church is always trying to de-Hinduize, but it's very difficult to do so. This idea of Hinduism, this way of life, always creeps in however much people try to keep it out. But I'm not really qualified to talk to you about this history. What I wanted to do instead is, I was going to look at four films, but I've cut it back to two today for reasons of time. There are two mainstream films I'm going to show you from the mainstream Hindi film industry, not the art cinema, or this is a commercial cinema. This is India's most popular cinema. I looked at a political film that I thought of talking about, Saat Hindustani, Seven Indians, which was, on watching it was quite unwatchable, about six men from all over India coming to fight with a Goan woman for the liberation of India, but the script and the story fell apart so badly, there wasn't so much to retrieve in it. And then another one, a film which I think is one that I would recommend, Trikal, Three Eras, or Past, Present and Future, directed by one of India's great art filmmakers, Shyam Benegal, but it didn't sort of fit with these other images. This is about a Portuguese family facing up to what the change of 1961 that was coming. So instead I've taken two films which I thought at first were coincidentally from the 1970s, but maybe I'll find out more about why the 1970s later on. Bobby, director Raj Kapoor, one of India's most popular filmmakers, said to be a great favourite, Chairman Mao, a hero in the former Soviet Union. These films have been watched worldwide except in Europe and North America. And Amar Akbar Anthony, which I've already mentioned in the introduction. So let me say a little bit about Bobby here, about this idea of young love, love as friendship, and so on. So Bobby is the name of the girl in the film. Her name is Bobby Braganza, and that's become a sort of immortal name in the history of Indian cinema. Perhaps it's no coincidence that it was Catherine of Braganza who brought the British Bombay as part of her dowry when she married our King Charles II. This film was made by the great director Raj Kapoor, who'd been celebrated in India since the 1940s. The Kapoors are this huge dynasty of filmmakers, 14 major film stars are from this one family. And he'd finished acting, so he wanted to make a teenage love story with his son Rishi as the hero and this new heroine called Dimple acting in it. And in the film, the story is rather simple. The character called Raj has just finished school and returns to his rich but unloving family. He meets Bobby, who's the granddaughter of his wet nurse, Mrs. Braganza, and falls in love with her, but his parents forbid the relationship. So it's a sort of Romeo and Juliet story, though they changed the ending for box office success, with many hit songs in it. And the film is remembered largely for the outrageously fashionable clothes of the youngsters, hot pants, bikinis, mini skirts, leather suits. And this really inspired not just one generation, but two or three generations of filmmakers to follow on. And this idea of the romantic hero, the teenagers, these are actually teenagers, normally in Hindi films, teenagers, the leading stars at the moment are in their 50s. But here we actually have real teenagers here, and we see them acting here in a fantasy of modernity. This is nothing like India could ever have been in the 1970s, the idea of what Christians do and what they get up to. I should just emphasise, Raj is a Hindu, presumably from his name, and his family practices. Bobby Braganza is quite clearly a Goan Roman Catholic, and there is no objection to the difference in religion between the families, only in class and culture. So I just want to give you an idea of how they perceived Goan culture to be. Bobby's father is a fisherman. The Goans in Goa are in different caste groups. They brought their caste groups from Hindu traditions. So we have the elite Brahminical caste, and we also have the fisherman caste, very low caste. And her father, Jack Braganza, is shown here when the rich Raj comes wanting to propose marriage to his daughter. This is the Goan culture he finds. This is meant to be a Goan wedding, and how different the Goans are from the Hindus.
मैं
idea of a boy and a girl going to a cafe, the ashtray, I mean, all the accoutrements here of this modern lifestyle which Bobby has, despite not being from a wealthy family, whereas Raj, being from a super wealthy family, is caught up in all these traditions and ways of behaving. And the difference between them seems to have nothing to do with religion, but to do with class as something different. Goans are just seen as a kind of almost an eccentric group of Hindus, perhaps, rather than being fundamentally different in these films. And this is something in Raj Kapoor's film. Raj Kapoor had been brought up all over India, in Calcutta, Bombay, and so on, because people were very used to the idea of Christians as their teachers. Many people went to Christian schools, they were made to say Christian prayers, but never found any conflict with that in their lives. It's only recently that these issues have been brought up and been politicised. The idea that many hospitals in India are Christian foundations as well. So people are used to the idea of Christians, particularly in cities like Bombay, where whole suburbs are Christian, marked by churches, marked by Christian celebrations, language, and so on. Very different, different ways of seeing things. And Amar Akbar Antony, which is set in Bombay, shows these different communities and their sacred spaces, the Hindu temple, the Muslim mosque or shrine, and the Christian church. And when the three brothers are separated, the brother Antony is found by a Catholic priest and brought up in the church. So he grows up speaking English. He becomes a smuggler, seen as he runs a wine shop. And he always says, you know, I give 50% of what I earn to Jesus and 50% for myself. Jesus and I are friends. And this becomes very much a trope within the film of this idea of all the religions being equal. And but somehow this idea of the star playing the Christian character, I think, is hugely important. In some ways it gives him a special importance within the film. Yes, he's drunk, he speaks a funny language. I mean, I don't know if you noticed, Jack Braganza calls another man sweetheart and things, you know, it's English, but not quite as it's spoken. But here in Amar Akbar Antony, what's interesting, we have different Christians. We have the Goan Christian of Antony Gonzalez, but we have Anglo-Indians, people of mixed descent, usually British and Indian here. They seem to have foreign connections. They're certainly not Goans. They're called Robert and Albert, and they live a very different life here. And they live in this area of Bandra in Bombay, now the hipster area of Bombay, where you can't move for a hipster, but one of the oldest areas of Christianity in India, with churches built in the 16th century, still parish churches. And this huge basilica where Amitabh Bachchan grows, as a character grows up. I don't know why these two big films were in the 1970s, particularly. Maybe it's the growth of domestic tourism, because for the rest of India, Goa remains this exotic area, this idea of it being of bars. It has a high number of bars, alcohol consumption, being much higher there, cheap beach shacks, the hippie trail, which began in the 1960s, still continues today, though in different forms. The idea of coming there to meet slightly different food, to meet more Westerners, the idea that you can wear what you like and do what you like. And in a way, an erasure of the Goan people themselves. They're not seen as being important. They're not really seen in these films. Goa is just this tourist space. It's an unpeopled space with this exotic heritage. They're not really seen as an important other. And from in the 1970s, many of these communal conflicts in India were growing, which we saw rise in the 1990s. We saw urban riots in Bombay, in which over 1,000 people were killed. In Hindu-Muslim disturbances. We saw in the early 2000s in Gujarat riots again, in which many were killed, many lost their homes. And the rise of policies in India, of Hindu nationalism, India for Hindus, I think changing this situation very much. And in Goa, we're seeing, we just saw this week, again, a chief minister from this Hindu nationalist party, and the conflict between them and the church being something which is great political negotiation there. We haven't really seen more of Goa recently in films, because I think really this is what it means. It's a pretty heritage area for the rest of India. It's not something which is so important. And there's really lack of any knowledge of the idea that most people from Europe are, I mean, we're called foreigners, Ferengis, which means Franks, it means French. We're seen, you know, we're all seen as that group, but we're all seen as being white Christians. And the idea that the West could be more complicated and more hybrid is something that only the elite cosmopolitans would really be familiar with. Portugal is not something that's really very well known in India today. We have, when we were looking at BRICS, and the only Indian film we could think of that was set in the Portuguese speaking world really is Doom 3, which is a thriller filmed in, sorry, Doom 2 in Brazil. Portugal, I mean, Brazil is quite interested in India. You've probably heard of this famous soap opera, Bollywood soap opera, that's been very popular and running there. But I don't know why the Hindi film industry, which loves overseas locations, doesn't use Portugal as one of its destinations. Spain is very popular. And since a big film was made in Spain a few years ago called You Only Live Twice, Indigina Milegi Dobara, it's become a really hot destination for wealthy Indians. So why Portugal isn't doing this, I don't really know. Goa itself, these images of Goa have become so powerful, it's become an area for middle class and elite tourism. The literary elites from Bombay, Delhi and overseas are all buying houses there. I mean, I went for a walk there in August last year and met four people I knew on the road, because they were mostly from overseas, because this is the way Goa is seen as being, again, this empty space. It's also the home of India's major international film festival, so it brings people into that who again see this touristy image of food, drink and beaches and so on, and also is somewhere to come and film, because it's got great connectivity by air and rail and road to particularly the cities of Mumbai and Chennai, Bombay and Madras. The heritage of Goa is becoming taken seriously. Awareness of the houses and the lifestyle and culture among local groups, and its whole fashion design and the aesthetic of Goa. As if it was hotter today, I'd be wearing some of them myself. But really, what is this kind of image of Goa within Indian cinema, I think, is quite important. We always talk about East and West binaries, but we're seeing something much more complicated here. Hindi cinema is really, after Hollywood, perhaps the world's only real global cinema. This is a popular commercial cinema which travels the world, has vast audiences worldwide. In the West now, the diaspora have brought it there, but it has audiences across the whole of Asia, you know, from former Soviet Union, very popular films, right across through Iran, nowadays in Israel as well, China, Japan. These films are all well known. So they are presenting an image of India that is India's own image of itself. So we don't really have the Western gaze on it as such, but then to suggest Indian cinema is anything other than hybrid would be wrong. Indian cinema starts in the same time as Western cinema, and it is influenced by Western cinema, but it has its own aesthetic, stories, visuals as well. This kind of mix of the two is there really from the very beginning of this cinema. And how it then sees the exotic, I think, is important. The West is exotic, for sure, but the West is largely, again, this empty consumerist space. You know, you go to London to go shopping and to meet other Indians. You don't go to meet other people. That's not what it's about. You can be a migrant, but you still long to go home. You still have to show yourself to be a true Indian, wherever it is in the world you live here. So really, perhaps this is internal exoticism, something more important here? And what does it say? I mean, for the representation of Christians, it's hugely important. You know, there have been many murderous attacks on missionaries in India. There is also the idea that you're in a state where Christians are a minority, a powerful minority, but you're not part of the ideology of what it means to be Indian nowadays. Even in the great idea of Hinduism, of Hindu nationalism, sorry, not Hinduism, the idea of who is a Hindu becomes important. In the colonial period, Christianity was often seen as being Hinduism's other, and great thinkers like Gandhi, de Gaulle, Vivekananda, Michael Mottisudan Dutta, and people thought about modelling Hinduism on the lines of Christianity. And that became an idea of, you know, the West was powerful because it was Christian and had these virtues as part of it. So then what does it mean nowadays when Muslims are the other and not a liked other? I mean, you know, the conflicts and communalism, separatism, where do Christians fit in nowadays? And although we're not looking at the voices of the Goans themselves by looking at these films, we're having an idea of how other Indians see Goa. And perhaps this status of being these mild eccentrics is a very safe space to occupy, rather than being seen as being the other. Now, Goans, as you know, have the option to migrate to Portugal quite often, and many of them have taken this option to migrate to Portugal, but have then moved directly to England and have set up their own communities there in England because somehow this connection seems to be part of it. But I think while there are massive political implications, which are certainly present in this idea of the film and perhaps the attenuation of Goa as a site of Goans and just part, sort of, you know, slightly exotic beach colony of India is important. But when we're looking at cinema, I think we can then shift the balance to the idea of the exotic as something, I'm thinking of Huggins' arguments here, of the cinema itself being seen as exotic and the idea of the exotic, but the representations within cinema, the aesthetics, how does exoticism then apply to them? And I think here we might be finding this category of the exotic something worth recuperating, rather than talking about Orientalism and Occidentalism, which don't actually seem to apply here. And this is something I know I'm fully aware that I haven't thought about more, but to end up with this idea of religion, ethnicity, nationality, as ideas that can be considered through a frame of exotic representation, perhaps, rather than these. So, let me see. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to sort of bring this towards the conclusion and show you the song from Amar Akbar. I show you the songs because the dialogues are very long. A scene in Hindi film is very long. You know, the films are over 3 hours long usually. The scenes are usually 12 minutes. It's very hard to edit. And then the subtitles are usually so wonky that I think perhaps the songs themselves, being seen as the exotic focus of cinema and the way they do it themselves. So at the end of Amar Akbar Antony, we have the reunion. The brothers know who they are. They have to rescue their three women who have been kept hostage by the Anglo-Indians in a house in Bombay. It's very silly because they're looking for Amar Akbar Antony and they're singing a song about themselves and the people don't seem to be listening to the words, in which they go in to rescue themselves. And I think it's quite significant. One of the lasting images we have of this film is Amitabh Bachchan dressed up as a Roman Catholic priest.
Yeah!
I was wondering about the role of the stereotype the stereotype seems to be something very strong. And yet, for instance, in the West, the stereotype tends to be seen something as politically incorrect. On the other hand, in Indian cinema, stereotype plays a very important role, that sense of humor, and that's not the standard form of correctness.
No, I mean, the Hindi film certainly would score 0 points for political correctness. But I think it's also this idea of melodrama, you know, that people are understood to archetypes, well, stereotypes. So, you know, if you're a Goan, you have to perform as a Goan. If you're a Muslim in a film, you can't just be somebody who's like the hero who happens to have a Muslim name. You have to perform as a Muslim. And the idea, you know, I'm thinking is that you can take something like, you know, Butler's gender performativity. In India, you have the same compulsion to have a religious performativity, apart from the Hindu male. The Hindu male is normal, and everything else is different. So it's a religion, it's a region. The North Indian male is normal. South Indians are hilarious. You know, people from other regions of India are bizarre. So, you know, you can have a whole comedy built around people's regional accents, regional dress, regional cuisine. It's all seen in a way as being sort of humorous. And one thing that you have, because of Indian legislation, you're not allowed to hurt the sentiments of any community. So every time a film comes out, the community will object. You know, at the moment there's a big film being made in Rajasthan, there was an objection to being stalled. And in India, when you say, you know, it's not just a sort of few letters in the papers, we're often talking about riots, cinemas getting trashed and so on. With Amar Antony, there was a moment when they alleged that when the priest's father died, they put the body on the altar. They didn't actually, they put it near the altar. But the Catholic Church objected, and then after that, they were filming in churches without permission. Whereas in the among the Goan community, this idea of themselves, you know, that in, I mean, there's a sort of borderline between celebrating the stereotype. So, you know, we are happy-go-lucky, you know, we like a drink or two, you know, we're more interested in love and things than we are in money. And so that will be accepted to a point, but then there are other points beyond which, you know, it's a bit like where do you tell certain jokes, you know, do you tell them among your close friends, your intimates, or whoever. And I think the Hindi film can often suffer from this, but often it can appear to an outsider offensive and racist. And one of the things that was quite interesting about Amar Akbar Antony is it's made by a Gujarati Hindu, Brahmin, and the actors in it are from a mixed of background. The three men are all upper caste Hindus from North India, but the women are actually more mixed in it. So you have again this idea of who can play who, and I think nowadays, if you were, say, to have a religious film, you couldn't have it in former days a Christian